The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good morning, everyone. I'm Joel Gilmet, the pastor of Sudbury United Methodist Church. We are gathered to worship on January 30th, 2022. It's a morning with lots of challenges, 2 feet of brand new snow outside. Heat is malfunctioning in here a little bit. And our YouTube connection is apparently not as stable as we would like, but we will record throughout the service so that it will be available on Sudbury TV's website later on. Let us pause as the prelude begins so that we can give ourselves to God and to this hour of prayer in spirit and in truth.
Good morning, everyone, on this bright and sunny morning. Would you all please stand and join me in the call to worship? You'll have to respond loudly in order to to be heard in the live stream. Okay. In Judah, God is known. In Israel, God's name is great. From the heavens, you utter your judgments, O God. The earth fears and keeps still. Our hymn is number 577, God of Grace and God of Glory. Thank you. Please join me in the opening prayer. God of Israel, we come to worship today to hear your good news, to open our hearts to the faith, hope, and love ringing out from your realm of truth. We know that doubt, intimidation, and fear can shake even the strongest of your prophets. So shape us into faithful and fearless people for the living of these days. We pray this together in the name of Jesus, whose faithful and fearless witness inspires us now and always. Amen. Our reading from the Gospels is in Luke chapter 4. Verses 21 through 30. As the reading begins, Jesus is at the synagogue in Nazareth and has just read a passage from the scroll that described his intended ministry. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at his gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me the proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself.' And you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.' And he said, 'Truly, I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of the town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
It's time for this week's conversation with the children. Here comes Serafina to grab a microphone. Serafina, we're going to talk about baseball today. Woohoo! What was the big baseball news in Boston this week?
There was a game.
There was a baseball game in Boston?
I don't follow baseball.
Not at all, right?
None.
No. Okay. We've got problems then, right? You have no idea what happened?
Absolutely none.
Big Poppy got elected to the Hall of Fame. You don't even know who Big Poppy is, right?
I do.
Oh, good. That's good.
Surprisingly.
That's good. Now, behind you, show to the camera and to the folks in the congregation. I've already seen that picture. Any idea who that is? And trying to read the name is going to be tough. His name is Del Ennis. He played for the Philadelphia Phillies in the 1950s when I was younger than you. And he never got elected to the Hall of Fame, even though his stats were as good as Mickey Mantle, Ted Williams, Willie Mays, Duke Snyder, and Gil Hodges. All of those names mean nothing to you, right?
Only Ted Williams.
I'm sorry?
Only Ted Williams.
Okay, you got Ted Williams. He was a Boston guy. All right, so, Del Ennis played for Philadelphia in the same town where he grew up. He played baseball in high school. The coaches were watching him. They brought him into the Phillies. He went off to World War II, I think, for a bit, and then came back. And in 1950, he led his team to their first pennant in like years and years and years, kind of like Big Poppy used to lead Boston to our first pennant like 80-something years. So he was a big deal. Lots of home runs, lots of runs batted in, played left field. And yet, even though he was the hometown hero, whenever he took the field, his friends from Philadelphia booed him. They booed and booed and booed him. Because something happened in Del Ennis's mind between 1950 and 1951. In 1950, things were going great. In 1951, he couldn't get a hit. He had a real block. And so the fans would boo him when he came on the field and when he left, when he came up to bat. Sometimes the booing enraged him and he was able to hit the ball out of the park. But most of the time, the booing just got into his head and he couldn't do a thing. He froze, choked at bat. So he got traded to the Cardinals. And when the Cardinals were on the road, he traveled with a man. His roommate was Stan Musial, the original Stan the Man. And Stan said to Del Ennis, when you retire, you should buy a bowling alley and run a bowling alley for the rest of your life. And he did. And that's how he finished his life not all that long ago. We talk about Del Ennis and the way he was treated by his neighbors because that's how Jesus was treated by his neighbors in Nazareth. The story that Richard just read is part two of last week's story. Everybody loved what Jesus had to say at first. But then something changed. Do you have any idea what happened that made them turn against him?
They didn't like what he was saying.
They didn't like what he was saying. They wanted him to do some great stuff in their town. And Jesus said, you know, that's not the way God works. God loves the people in Sidon and Syria. He quoted the Bible to them and said, you know, not much going to happen here because God's focus is turned on other places. And so they grabbed him and shoved him to the edge of town and tried to kill him. A another hometown hero for whom things did not work out well. Sometimes that's true in our lives, right? We wish that the people in our own hometown would love us more. But Jesus reminds us that God's focus is wider than ours, and that God is always working in places that we can't see. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you that you invite us to have a little part in your big plan. We pray that you will teach us how to do what you ask us to do without looking for praise and applause, so that we can fulfill your purposes, not just for our own lives, but for the life of this planet. Teach us to be like Jesus, who went against the grain in his hometown. Make us brave and strong and faithful. We ask in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
In my heart, I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad, he has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He's made me glad. He's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He's made me glad. He's made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
Today's reading from the Old Testament is found in Jeremiah chapter 1. We begin at verse 4. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, ah, Lord God, truly I don't know how to speak, for I'm only a boy. But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am only a boy, for you shall go to all to whom I send you, and you shall speak whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, says the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to pull down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant. The word of God. Thanks be to God. Years ago, after my first Sunday in a new church, a retired pastor, a fellow United Methodist, phoned me to let me know that he was coordinating a network of volunteer chaplains for the hospital in that city. It was a big waste of money, he said, for the hospital to hire a full-time chaplain because he was willing to recruit volunteers, retired clergy like himself, and active clergy like your predecessor, he hinted. He was willing to do all that to cover the hospital's chaplaincy needs. It worked like a charm, he promised. 1 month at a time, volunteers agreed to carry a beeper. When the beeper went off, you called the hospital. If he couldn't take the call himself, someone in the emergency department would pick up. From there, you would be told who was calling for a chaplain and why. And then you would have 15 minutes to drop everything and go to the hospital. Think of it as community service, he said, a network of community-minded clergy giving back. And best of all, he added, after my 1 month stint was over, I would not be asked to carry the beeper again for another year. What could I say? I was new in town and I wanted to be helpful like my predecessor. But to be honest, I had a few questions, more like reservations. What would I do, for example, if the beeper went off on Sunday while I was preaching? Would I drop everything and run? And how often did patients call for a chaplain in the middle of the night? And how would I know what to say if I was in over my head? And who would cover if I got sick during my month on call and I couldn't drop everything? Don't worry, he said to me. It works like a charm. Try it for 1 month and let me know. So I said yes. Eventually, he came to the church, sat in my office, handed me the beeper. And to be honest, for one long month, I lived with anxiety and fear. With that beeper next to my bed every night, I could hardly sleep. On Sundays, when I was preaching, I broke the rules. I turned it off. If I was relaxing, trying to enjoy some family time, leaving town was out of the question because I had to stay within 15 minutes of the hospital. And after 1 month of carrying that ball and chain beeper. I brought it back to the guy who recruited me. I looked him in the eyes and I said, never again, not on your life. And get this, the beeper never even beeped, not even once. Today's reading from Jeremiah, especially Jeremiah's obvious anxiety and trepidation, reminds me of the one and only month in my life I was required to carry a beeper. Before I formed you in the womb, God says to the son of a priest whose family was punished for criticizing a king, before you were born, I knew you and I appointed you to be a prophet to the nations. No wonder Jeremiah had questions. No wonder he was anxious and frightened. For the rest of his life, God was asking him to carry a beeper right here next to his heart, to swim against the tide, to be a pest, a social critic in the halls of power, like Al Sharpton and Greta Thunberg all rolled into one. God was asking Jeremiah to be God's spokesperson, denouncing injustice, declaring God's judgment on his own nation and on nations near and far. What a life. What kind of choice was that for a young person to make? Instead of working on getting into a good college and starting a great career, God was asking Jeremiah to carry the beeper right here in his heart, to live with the anxiety of knowing that God might give him a buzz at any moment to speak truth to power, to hold kings accountable, to risk his neck. No wonder Jeremiah had some questions, more like reservations. How could he be God's mouthpiece? Public speaking was not his thing. How could he fight City Hall? He was only a youth. How could he pretend to be a prophet to the nations? It was hard enough telling his own friends to stop racist jokes, reminding total strangers in the supermarket not to slap the kids squalling in their carts. That is what it's like when God's beeper goes off in your heart. Whether you're a prophet in the big picture social justice sense of that word, or in the little picture love your neighbor sense of the word, it's like being on call morning, noon, and night. It's like knowing that God expects you to be God's voice in all kinds of sticky, risky situations. Before he retired, a minister here in the Metro West area used to tell his congregation about his grandmother and how she felt called by God to be a Presbyterian pastor when she was only 14 years old. We're talking about Michigan in the 1890s. She was quiet. She was an introvert, a farm girl who had never seen a woman standing in the pulpit, not even once, not even to make announcements in the church. She must have known that ordained ministry could be tough, a pain in the neck, criticism galore, saying things congregations did not want to hear. But already at 14 years old, God's beeper was buzzing in her heart. So she went to the church to have a talk with her pastor. "God is calling me to preach," she said. "I'm sorry," he replied. "You must be mistaken. God does not call women to preach." A few days later, her father knocked on the pastor's door. He was not happy. "If Emma says she's called to preach," he began, "she is called to preach. And I'll tell you something else. Emma could preach circles around any boy in this county." In 1902, Emma was ordained, but not by Presbyterians. She spent the rest of her life serving congregational churches. My colleague remembers that his grandmother was almost painfully shy. His words: "Not exactly a big personality in the pulpit, but still she knew that she was called. Leading worship, she was quiet," he says, "but she was also confident and strong. During coffee hour, however, Reverend Emma looked like she wanted to fade into the woodwork." Today's reading from Jeremiah reminds us that God calls unlikely people to be God's messengers, prophets and preachers who make church entertaining most of the time, whose sermons send people home feeling lighthearted and carefree, are few and far between. In the United States, believe it or not, 75% of all pastors are introverts, men and women who would rather fade into the woodwork than stand in a pulpit. And yet God calls them, as unlikely as they are, to march in where angels fear to tread. But listen, people who carry God's beeper are not just pains in the neck. They are also gifts to be treasured. They're not arrogant know-it-alls too big for their britches. More often than not, they are reluctant to speak, amazed to be called, and happier to be quiet, except for one inconvenient truth. God's word is pulsing in their hearts. Young and old, bold and tongue-tied, women and men, gay and straight and trans, God calls all kinds of people to be prophets and preachers, people like Jeremiah and Emma, who would rather do anything else except for one scary promise: "I have put my words in your mouth," God says, "to pluck up and to pull down, to build and to plant." In 1944, Corrie ten Boom was imprisoned in Ravensbrück because she and her family sheltered Jews in a secret apartment over her dad's watchmaking shop. They called that apartment the hiding place. It became the title of her first book. Wendy and I heard Corrie ten Boom when we were college students. Ever since, her example has inspired us. Called by God to be daring, called by God to be courageous with nothing to lean on but God's own presence and promise. One day when the hiding place was filled to capacity, Corrie had a talk with her father. "I'm afraid," she said, "that I will never be strong enough to give my life for Jesus." Her father answered, "Listen, when you take the train, when do I give you the money for your ticket?" "Do I give you the money 3 weeks ahead of time?" "No, Daddy," she said. "You give me the money right before I get on the train." Today, her father explained, "You don't need the strength to give your life for Jesus. But as soon as you are called, God will give you the strength. God will give you everything you need just in time, but not 1 minute before." At Ravensbrück, the prison guards called the Bible Das Lügenbuch, the book of lies. People caught reading the Bible or talking about God were executed immediately. Knowing the consequences, Corey opened her Bible one night to read to her fellow inmates. Suddenly, one of the prisoners silently mouthed the words, "Hide your Bible, Corey. It's Loni. She's standing right behind you." Everyone knew Loni. She was the most sadistic female guard in the camp. But Corey kept reading, knowing that Loni was standing behind her, listening to every word. Finally, Corey said, "Let's sing a hymn." And they did, with fear in their hearts. At the end of the hymn, Loni barked, "Another song, just like that." So they sang again. And as Loni led Corey away, they prayed for her. Corey had no idea what to say to the prison guard. So she just told her about her faith in Jesus. Never before, she remembered later, "Never before had I felt such peace and joy in the presence of my enemy. My dad was right. The money for the train came just when I needed it." Is God calling you to carry God's beeper? In one way or another, God calls all of us. Do you feel God's word pulsing in your heart? Are you tongue-tied by fear, wishing you could fade into the woodwork? Guess what? People like you are totally qualified to speak for God, just as much as Pastor Emma, just as much as Corey Ten Boom and Jeremiah. Young or old, talkative or tongue-tied, God calls all kinds of people to be prophets and preachers, with nothing to lean on but one promise. "I have put my words in your mouth," God says, "to pluck up and to pull down, to build and to plant." The next time you feel the buzz in your heart, open your mouth and let God take care of the rest. Amen.
Thank you.
Welcome again to worship at Sudbury United Methodist Church. It's January 30, 2022. It's feeling warmer. Thanks to our custodian who came in while we were here to jumpstart whatever was not working. Are we still on YouTube, Matt? Looking good? People behind me are saying you've jinxed us now. Yeah. Things are heading in a good direction, and we are moving toward prayer. Let us listen with open hearts and minds as Richard reads this week's concerns and celebration.
We'll begin with the concerns. Jackie Kessler is receiving palliative care in a hospice unit of Mass General Hospital. Please hold Jackie and Carol and their daughter Courtney in your prayers during this tender time. Please hold Dean and Barbara Horman in prayer as they grieve the passing of their daughter Julie last Monday. She was 59 years old. Nan Okarma asks our prayers for her brother, nieces, and the rest of her family following the death of her sister-in-law last Wednesday. And Tom Gerald's bladder cancer has recurred. The oncologist believes it's a superficial recurrence, but has scheduled Tom for a resection and biopsy this Tuesday, February the 1st. Please hold Tom and his family in prayer as they wait for results. on Friday, Heather Johnson Cranston's cousin, Tony, underwent surgery to amputate part of her foot due to infection. Tony needs our prayers as she recovers from surgery and learns how to adapt. Thank you, Heather.
Let us pray. O God, for the call that you give all your people to speak for you when you nudge our hearts, we give you thanks. We also confess our reservations. Your word is sometimes comforting and cheerful, and other times challenging and disruptive. We live in a time of disruption. We have heard the challenging voices of those you have called to speak prophetically. We wonder how we will be able to be faithful to the responsibilities you lay on all of us. But we are trusting you to guide our tongues, to enlighten our minds, and to fill our hearts with love for those to whom we speak, so that your word will not only tear down, but also build up, not only uproot, but also plant a new and better harvest. Remember, we pray, those whose names and needs we've heard today, our friends and loved ones who are grieving the passing of dear ones, who are concerned about their health and the health of those they love, who wonder how they will make it with faithfulness through the times of challenge in which they live. Fill them with your own courage, O God. Come close in the presence of your Holy Spirit and lead them to see the light that you are shining, even in times of shadows. We bow before you, O God, because you alone are the one who holds our lives in your hands. We trust you and pray again for the courage to be faithful, like those who across the centuries have sung out, "Here I am, Lord. I will hold your people in my heart." Receive our prayers because we offer them through Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior, who has taught us to call out to you with all your children when we say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Good morning. My name is Kate Moser, and I would like to tell you about the Sunday morning group that is starting back in person next week and invite you to join us for this time of spiritual reflection and fellowship. We will meet from 8:45 to 9:15 a.m. in the O'Reilly Room prior to worship. You may be familiar with the Upper Room, a daily devotional booklet. Each week, we will read the Bible passage and associated devotion from the previous Wednesday's entry, because there are discussion questions at the back of the book that will go along with that day's entry and will serve as a great starting point to guide our conversations. This format will allow us to reflect on how we can bring God's love and the wisdom contained in the Bible into our daily lives. Each week, we will focus on a slightly different topic, so if you can't make it every week, don't worry, you will not be behind. We will be taking a number of safety precautions, just as we are doing in worship. We will have a HEPA filtration machine running, we'll crack the windows, wear masks, and socially distance. If we need a bigger space, we will relocate to another room in the church. And I'd just like to add that before the pandemic, the Sunday morning Bible study group used to meet in person, and I found it to be a great way to forge connections and grow spiritually with my brothers and sisters here at SUMC. In a time now when many of us may be feeling socially or spiritually disconnected, I hope this group will provide an opportunity for us to reflect, share, and grow together. We welcome anyone who is interested to join us Sunday mornings at 8:45, starting this coming Sunday, February 6th. We will have plenty of Upper Room booklets on hand, but if you would like your own, we have them just outside the O'Reilly Room entrance. And you can also access the devotions on the Upper Room app on your phone. Thank you for your time this morning. And now with the ushers, please come forward for the morning offering.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear as long as you are here. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now I will not forget love for me, and yet my heart, if ever, is wandering.
Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side,
and I will love you to the end. Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Oh, thy word is a lamp unto my feet.
please join with me in the offertory prayer. Loving God, we have been blessed with so much through your goodness and faithfulness. As we bring our gifts to your altar with gratitude, remind us that no gift can be complete without love. And remind us also that love can never be complete without truth. Prepare us, God of love, to speak boldly in your name by giving us hearts filled with compassion and tongues guided by truth. So may we give ourselves and our gifts more faithfully to you and to your mission to redeem and rebuild creation. We pray for these blessings through Christ, our faithful teacher and truthful example. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 578, God of Love and God of Power.
Peace, love God, serve your neighbor in all that you do. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the companionship of the Holy Spirit be with you today and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.